Johnny with Bloody Disgusting. I'm here with Nick from Job from a Cowboy. How are you doing, sir?
I'm awesome today. How about yourself? Huh?
You're putting some strange emphasis on those syllables.
Emphasis on those syllables? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fun to mix it up a little bit, you know what I mean? Sometimes I like to play with, you know, maybe, and when and the auto cuts out a little bit. It's crazy. It's like one of those things.
This is going to drive the YouTube people crazy. Be like, what the fuck is wrong with my audio?
Some things, if you want to get, you can check it out. Think it's something wrong that way. Some, if it is, you just like tweak it a little. There's a little button on the bottom if you push the little gear, and there's like 1080p, 720. Maybe just click it down.
Make this down to 144.
144.
Yeah.
It's a really excellent number.
Yeah, that reminds me of playing the old NES.
Square root is 12.
There you go. There you go. We have a mathematician here. All right, so how's Mayhem treating you?
Amazing, man. It's the best, one of the best times I've ever had in my life, for sure.
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, you know, my mom got to come out yesterday and, you know, hang out all day long. We get to play wiffle ball, go backstage, hang out. You know, there's a party afterwards.
Your mom tore it up. She was the life of the party, wasn't she?
She was dancing, and she was getting down with the Butcher Babies. Yeah, it was cool, man. Yeah, she was dancing, for real. Yeah, it was fun as hell. And, you know, playing to these amazing, amazing States crowds. Best States crowds I've ever gotten to play to. Playing with bands I grew up listening to. It's the best time I've had in life so far.
It's like living a dream a bit, huh?
Yeah, literally, man. Yeah.
Nice.
It's awesome.
Okay, Demonocracy. Came out last year.
Great.
What's status on a new album?
We're shooting for April 2014.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Stuff written?
Yeah, we have a couple, 2-3 songs written right now. And we're going to basically... we're going to wait and see what happens post-Mayhem. You know, usually there'll be some type of an offer that'll come in that we might not be able to refuse. So if that does happen, then we're going to take it. There may be like 5 days in South America that I'm really pushing for us to do. But other than that, the main focus is just to be back and hit the writing really hard. Try to get in the studio in the fall or winter and then have the record out in April.
Okay. Any so stuff's been written or?
Yeah. Al's got a couple songs.
How's it sounding?
It's cool. I think we're going to, you know, the emphasis is going to be to get weird.
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, I think, like, you know, we kind of came together on Gloom and on, specifically on Demonocracy, to kind of showcase, like, all right, look, we got new bassists, new guitarists, they can play their instruments, you know, really well or whatever, so let's kind of showcase that. And so it's a really dense, you know, riff mansion, you know, kind of showing off all the new licks, Tony's licks and the solos and that kind of stuff. And I think this time around, there might be more emphasis placed on mood.
Okay. That could be a lot of fun because atmosphere can be a huge, huge thing with an album.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, I definitely agree. He's a great rapper. He's a nice guy, too.
Yeah.
I've always loved dynamics as my most important. My most, like, dynamics and space and rest and music is what I love. Some of my elements of music, or the elements of music that I feel like are... I'm most attracted to, you know what I mean? So I'm going to try to influence that, you know, and I think the other guys want to do that too, you know, just have some more, like, you know, kind of moody stuff. There's always going to be room for technicality. There's always going to be room for brutality. You know, it's like comes with the genre, you know what I mean? So it's like, what other colors can you bring to the spectrum?
In a way, it's, you know, immediately, because, you know, from Bloody Disgusting, what I liken it to is a horror movie. You can have the intense violence, you can have the intense gore, the beautiful shots, but then it's those moments of rest, of respite, where you kind of, like, get a chance to breathe or get a chance to appreciate everything you've had, and then when it comes back, it's as, you know, just as invigorating, just as intense, if not more so.
Exactly. I totally agree. I think that's the play in between light and dark, yin and yang, you know what I mean? You have to have a balance. You have to have light in order to have a day, you know? Like, how do you know what pain is if you don't know what pleasure is? How do you know what pleasure is if you don't know what pain is? And I think that's art, is to play and display in between those two things.
And to quote Pinhead, pain and pleasure, indivisible.
There you go. Exactly. It's the same thing, you know? So I think it's kind of the thing. If it's all pain the whole time, you'd be like, this doesn't really hurt. I forgot that it hurts.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to have that little... the lulls in between, you know, like especially the, you know, for the old scary movie, you know, pop up, you know, you need that silence, you know, that's what, you know, it's amazing how silence builds suspense. Silence has such an effect in both film, visual aspect, the audio aspect, the score aspect, you know, dialogue, and all those things are 100% applicable. It could be describing the same thing, describing music.
Yeah, some of my favorite aspects of a horror movie is hearing the score, how it plays, and then figuring out, you know, where they have the silence, because you know, you just want to hear something, you need to hear something, and because it's not there, you're just like, you get uneasy, you get you know, unsettled. And, you know, hearing that with, you know, talk about that in relation to music, it's just as applicable, because having, as you say, those crushing moments, and then suddenly you've got that lull, it's surprising, it's off-putting, and it's incredibly dynamic. It takes you on a journey. It's not just you're sitting there, you've got it, and it's done. It's something that you have to invest in. You have to become a part of it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's almost like silence is almost like it almost invokes like vulnerability. You know, because you have to, like, you don't know what's going to happen, and you don't know how much time has passed. You know, like when you get pulled over and they want to do a roadside test or whatever, and they ask you sometimes when you're, one of the things where they can really tell if you're drunk is your estimation of time. You know, like they'd be like, oh, you know, estimate 30 seconds for us. You know, people's perception of time gets really screwed up when you get drunk. They usually think that more time has passed than really has. That's why, like, it's, you know, really traditional in music to hear of people rushing. You know, they rush the fills when you go and do the drum fill, or you're trying to, you know, finish your bass fill. You rush.
Yeah.
You know, because your perception of time is, especially with excitement and that kind of stuff, it's shorter. You're thinking that more time has passed than actually has. And so I think that's, you know, also a wonderful aspect or a wonderful way to play with people's, you know, kind of emotions, is to play with their perception of time. You know, and to do that, you know, like musically, is requires, you know, using a rest. Not, you know, death metal, it's a million notes, it's a million notes an album, right?
Yeah.
Especially our last one, a million notes on that record. You know what I mean? It's like, how do you fit, you know, the space in? It's like, all right, don't play anything. You know, nobody play anything.
Yeah.
Here, that's, you know, the space is what allows us to hear the music in the first place. It's the only reason that music can exist. It's a space around the notes. Otherwise, it'd be all notes at all times.
Yeah.
All noise at all times. You know, it's kind of like Superman. Remember that? Did you see the new Superman?
Unfortunately.
Okay. All right. Okay. But it was, you know, when he's like, when he comes and he's got to, like, hone his senses.
Yeah.
Because it's all coming in at once. You know, that's real. I mean, that's, you know, we're like, you know, these deletion, we're like these deletion machines where our brain has to filter out all the information that's coming in. Because we get, you know, something like 400 billion bits of information per second. But our conscious processing cuts it down to about 2,000 bits. Because that's what's, you know, processable for us to have, you know, this conversation right now and not, you know, have the birds and the generators and all the noise in the background and everything, you know, be so present that, you know, it's all just noise. You know what I mean? It's like, that's music. That's life. It's the space, the separation. So hopefully we'll bring some of that into the new record.
Well, and the thing is, in a way, we've kind of had a little bit of a teaser of that with the Tarnished Gluttony music video, because first of all, that's a fantastic music video. It's one of my favorites of 2012, and, you know, Michael Pandura did such an amazing job with it. And you know, it had the music, and then there was that break in the middle, that silence, but except there wasn't silence. It was the murder of that little boy,
right?
And then the music came back in and the story continued, and it was just such a powerful and intense music video. And something I wanted to ask you is that, for, you know, for a while there, music videos, they seemed to kind of fall by the wayside, or they were like performance videos. We get some live footage, we get you guys performing in a warehouse, that's really about it. Or you know, even and for a lot of times, what was even more popular was the lyric video.
Uh-huh.
It was super cheap.
Yep.
You didn't have to be in it at all. You didn't have to really care. And then that was it. And it's interesting because a lot of times the band video and the lyric video has more views.
Right.
Because people want to know what you're saying.
Right.
But then now there's starting to become this resurgence of interesting videos. You've got, you know, Phil Mucci, who's doing, you know, the video for Huntress. You've got Michael Panduro, who did, you know, Tarnished Gluttony. You've got Mitch.
Orworm,
yeah. Yep. And you've got Mitch Massey, who did Forced Gender Reassignment.
Jesus.
You know, you've got these videos that are suddenly, like, really visceral, really intense. There's a lot of thought goes into it, and they're really well done. They're beautiful, as a matter of fact.
Right.
Why do you think that's coming back?
I think it has to be, you know, something to do with, like, the creative aspects of, you know, some wonderful, you know, producers, you know, because I didn't come up, you know, like, for example, like, for the Orworm, you know, thing, like, he just, you know, hit us up. He was just like, hey, check it out, I'm a fan of the band, I made this Psyopus video, I've discovered that, you know, I like my job 10 times more when I'm working for people that I, you know, actually like the music for.
Yeah.
So he's like, you know, so when your next record comes around, hit us up. He was a secondary option. You know, the label's like, oh, we got this guy we want, he's gonna make this awesome video for you guys. And the video that guy made was just, you know, literally eighth grade garbage. You know what I mean? Just really bummed us out because we spent all this money on it. So the Orworm thing was like a secondary thing. He was just like, yo, if you let me have creative freedom, I'll do it essentially for free. You know, whatever my budget costs for my supplies and stuff. And he sent us that video. He sent us Orworm, and we were just like, what
it's,
the
it's
hell?
Fucking great.
You know? Yeah. Like, we're so amazed. Like, just the beautiful cinematography, videography, the color correction, the colors, and the play and display of it in the story, and you're just like, what the heck? And I think it makes people definitely think. And to me, like, that was like somebody, I think that there's these producers out there, these people that want to bring the video element back in to the music, and it's a wonderful way for people to expose it. Like, I think that those videos are like more for fans of, you know, horror or,
sure,
you know, or extreme, you know, film type of side of things, and then they just so happen to get into our music because of it. It's almost like the opposite.
I remember when Bloody Sisson was asked to premiere Orworm, you know, I looked at it, I was like, holy shit, you know, for the first time, I think, like, we may have a situation where it's like, can we do this? And I asked Brad, and I was like, you know, hey, is this going to be okay? He was like, just put an age gate, you're fine. And I was like, okay, nothing can, like, that is, the bar has been set. Nothing can reach that. And then suddenly, forced gender reassignment came, and it was like, okay.
That was it, yeah. You know, actually, there's a guy, I forget the guy's name who did the video, but it was, I know there was a Nine Inch Nails video. Oh my God. I think it was off of Broken. It was one of the songs off of Broken. Oh, I want to say,
is that the one where the guy's strapped in the chair and, like, the thing smacks his dick and then he's ground up?
Yeah. That was pretty gnarly for back then. That was back in the day, too. So you had to be able to get that.
But, and it's interesting that they would make that back in the day because there's nowhere to put it.
There was nowhere to put that.
Like, you don't have the internet at the level that it is now where you can stream that and make it something that goes viral.
That was even, like, almost pre-DVD. That was, like,
Before that was VHS.
You had to get that on VHS.
That was when you had to dial up into AOL.
56K. Or no, it was
what,
like,
are you kidding? 28.8.
14.4.
Yeah,
I remember those 14.4 modems.
I had 28.8. I was blazing.
28.8. Yeah. Smoking fast, man. You could get through. You know.
I could 3K a second download speeds. That was awful.
Yeah, and you could only, if you didn't want to pay for the AOL, then you would just get, like, you know, those free trial discs would have the code that was good for, like, a month.
Yep.
And just have, like, just thousands keep, of free codes.
Oh, yeah. Because you got one every, like, 2 days.
I miss that modem dial-up sound, you know, the connection.
Yeah.
That was a fun one.
Yep. So I got to ask, you know, what's next for you guys after Mayhem? What's after this? You were talking, you know, you've got the recording, you've got the album that you want to release in April of 2014, tentatively.
Right.
That's like a tentative date. You've got South America that you're really pushing for.
Right.
And you're saying that there might be some tours that you simply can't refuse.
Potentially in the fall, there could be some, there's a couple things on the table that we, depending upon what happens, we might definitely have to do it.
Okay.
But, you know, that would kind of take away from the focus on trying to get as prepared as possible for the record and try to maintain that timeline. But we, you know, we'll play with that timeline if we need to. I'd much rather spend and the extra time and make sure that a record is right than to hit a date, to hit a timeline.
Yeah.
And then it's not. Although, you know, you got to kind of hit that timeline if you want to do, if you want to have your touring schedule lined up. Because a lot of the festivals require the release, but within a certain amount of time. So, but definitely, I think most likely next year, we're going to probably be doing, I mean, if we could do Mayhem again, we would do it.
Yeah.
But probably, I don't know, we're probably going to be looking at maybe summer festivals in Europe.
Okay.
And then who knows? We'll kind of see what the offers go as far as, pretty excited to do it. I'm doing the exact same. I've done really well with the Sephalic and Job for Cowboy thing. Like, weaving the schedules around each other. They've been, you know, very DNA, kind of double helixed. And then now they're kind of like, oh, shit, same schedule. So Sephalic's got to write a new record, too. It's like the exact same scheduling now. So I'm like, got to figure out how to, like, offset them a tiny bit, but so I'll be working on that. I'm basically just gonna have to write my ass off, I think, when we get home.
It's not necessarily a bad place to be.
No, it's cool. I mean, I've been hitting the road pretty hard for this last year and a half, and I think it'd be cool to have a few months at home.
Yeah, would be good. So, last question, I gotta ask this for Bloody Disgusting. What are some of your favorite horror movies?
Oh, wow.
I'm putting you on the spot.
You know, I have to say, you know, one of my favorite ones was Dead Alive.
Peter Jackson.
Yeah.
Lawnmower scene.
I love the lawnmower scene was the best. I like the tongue in cheek aspect of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I kind of like the not taking yourself too seriously type of a thing. I really dig that side of things. Evil Dead, you know, is a pretty sick classic.
Drag Me to Hell also right, is a bit tongue-in-cheek.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. I used to like the Children of the Corn stuff when I was a kid, I think. You know, I haven't watched it in like 15 years or something, but I remember it being, you know, relatively... It was kind of cool when you dropped the house on the lady. That was fun.
Yeah.
And then, I don't know, what should I go check out?
Have you seen The Conjuring?
Okay, so the band's been talking... The tour's been talking about it.
Yeah.
Getting half and half reviews. The Bodom dudes said it was scary. Amon Amarth said it was not.
Okay. I loved it.
Okay.
Then again, I saw it twice. Okay. Once I saw it in a great theater with, you know, great projection, great sound, great audience, and it was fantastic. I saw it again in one of your, like, everyday theaters where the projection was a bit off, the sound wasn't as great, and the audience, they were the people that were like, oh, you know, it's a scary part, let me check my cell phone. And okay. As a result, it was not nearly the same experience. I still love it. I think it's fantastic. Okay. I think that how you were describing music, how there's a play, and, you know, it's very unique. I think Conjuring is very unique and interesting.
Okay.
Simply because a lot of the times, you know, how James Wan, he'll frame a scene, you'll look at it, and normally when you watch a movie, you're staring at one point on the screen.
Okay.
Here, you're looking everywhere because you're trying to anticipate where something is going to happen.
Cool.
So you're really involved and focused.
Gotta use like wide angle vision.
Yeah, you know? You're constantly like moving around, and it's a lot of fun. And the music by Joseph Bishara is, I mean, I love his work. It's fantastic.
That's awesome.
So I'm really excited for that. I'm super excited for Insidious 2.
Cool. Insidious. Yeah. Okay. Cool. I'll give Conjuring a go then.
Give it a go. All right. And if you don't like it, you know, you can, you know, send an angry email. You know, give Blood Discussing a 1-star review on Yelp or something.
That sounds awesome, man.
All right, sir. Thank you so very much for chatting.
Great conversation.
Best of luck, and you know, I can't wait for the new album.
Thanks very much, man. And thank you guys for always supporting us and putting the stuff up. We appreciate it, man.
We love it.
Need a place to display it. Although we did get Orworm on YouTube.
They finally allowed it?
Oh yeah, I talked to a guy. I talked to Panduro, and Panduro said that he was contacted. He said that, you know, obviously every single video that's on YouTube is viewed by somebody as for content, you know, within a certain amount of timeline.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that video is the benchmark.
Really?
For YouTube. What that is considered art. Anything past that is not.
And wow.
That's a benchmark for what YouTube allows for nudity.
You know, that must be a bit of an honor.
He was stoked on it.
Yeah.
I was like, congratulations, man. That's awesome. He was like, yes.
All right, sir. Again,
cool.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, of course. Thank you.
Take care.
All right, cool, man.